Okay, so how is everyone today? Good? I'm glad it's Friday. So last time we were talking about polynomials. We're still talking about polynomials. But we're going to slightly relax our considerations for a moment. So this is section 1.5, continued. So, on this page, if you're trying to make your pages look like my pages, I'm going to write in two columns. So, first example. Last time we did an example that looked like this. 24, x to 5, y to 3, minus 16, x to 2, y to 7. So we had something like this. And I said, I want you to factor out, I want you to factor this and do so by factoring out the greatest common factor. Okay. Now, when I do this, I'm going to show several steps that we didn't show last time. Because I'm going to show you something else where knowing that those were the actual steps will be beneficial to you. You wouldn't actually solve this one in the way I'm about to show you. Okay? So, okay. As for the coefficients, I can see that the greatest common factor is 8, so I'll factor it out. So then it'd be 3, x to 5, y to 3, minus 2, x to 2, y to 7. So far, so good, right? Just like last time. Now I'm going to deal with the x's. And the way I'm going to deal with the x's is I'm going to note, so here is here's x to 5, so its exponent is 5. And x to 2, its exponent is 2. And remember that x to 5 is actually just shorthand notation for x times x, times x times x times x. And x to 2 is actually shorthand notation for x times x. That's what it means. So here's our choices, just looking at the exponents. We can either take out, this is in a sense saying we can take out 5 from this term and 2 from this term, so how many are we going to take out? 2. And the reason why we're going to take out 2 is because that's the smallest one. That's the smallest one. Okay. So 8 and then x, and we're going to take out 2. So I'm going to mark that in red. And here's the part where I'm showing my work in a way that we didn't do it last time. So it would be 3x, and then we started with 5.
We started with 5. And now I'm going to take away 2.
And then we didn't do anything with the y, so just copy that. And then minus 2x. And we started with 2 of them. And then we took away 2. And then we didn't do anything with the y's.
Okay. So that's what actually factoring out things like a greatest common factor is doing. It's performing a subtraction in the exponent. It's performing a subtraction in the exponent. So if we do that, if we perform this subtraction, how many x's will be left in this term?
3.
So what would remain is 8x squared on the outside and then 3 x to 3, y to 3, minus 2. What would be the exponent here?
0.
So I'm going to write that this time. X to 0, y to 7. And then the last thing that I want to observe is that, well, what is x to 0?
It's 1.
It's 1, so that here we would have 8x to 2 on the outside, and then inside 3x to 3y to 3 minus 2y to 7. So what we did last time,
more or less, is we didn't show any of that. And on this particular exercise, because of the innate numeracy of humans, you don't really need to. Showing these work, this work on this problem is sort of more than what's necessary. Okay? And last time we jumped directly from here to here. Any question about this? So now let's just finish the exercise, but let's finish it in the quick way. How much y could we get out? 3, right?
So it would be 8 x squared y cubed, and then 3 x to 3 minus 2, and how much y? 4. Because
the action of taking out y to 3 performs a subtraction in the exponents, right? So here, because we're taking out 3, there'd be y to 0, which is 1. That's how much y is left here. And then here, there were 7, and we took away 3, so now there's 4. Any question about this? Okay, now here's where it becomes, mathematically it's exactly the same, but because of the way humans innately think about numbers, most students think that this question is completely different. Okay. How about 40 A to 5 B to 3 we'll do 3. Why not? And then minus 6 20 A to 2, B to negative 7. So this question is exactly the same, mathematically. But the fact that there's a negative exponent really disturbs a lot of work in students' exercises. So let's do the easy parts first. In the first place, the coefficients are still easy. And as for the a's, all of them have positive exponents, so that's exactly the same as last time. So let's do all of that at the same time.
So how much coefficient can we get out?
20.
And then how much a can we get out?
2,
right? So we can get out 20a squared. And what will the coefficient on this term be when we do that? Be 2. How much a will there be left in this term? A cubed, right? And then we're not messing with the b's yet. Then minus how much coefficient?
1.
1, right? So I'm not going to write it. And then we're not messing with the a's. Oh no, we are messing with the a's. That's the point. How much a? None, right? So a to 0. So what's left here is b to negative 7.
Okay. Any question about getting here? Now, do you observe that there's b's in all of these terms? That means b's are common. That means we can take some b's. And the question is,
the choice that we have to make is, here's positive 3 exponent b's, and here's negative 7. So these are our choices.
And my question to you is what are we going to take? The smallest one, which is negative 7. Negative 7 is smaller than 2. Because it's further to the left on the number line.
or to make it more real world, would you rather have $2,000 or negative $7,000? 2,000, I think, right? Okay.
So the smallest one is negative 7. So that's what's going to come out.
That's what's going to come out.
So then doing that, this first part just gets copied. So 20a squared. And we're taking out b to negative 7. So we would have b and then negative 7 exponent. That's what's coming out. Okay, as for the first term inside of the parentheses, it'll be 2a cubed b, and then we started with 3 of them.
We started with 3 of them, and we're taking away negative 7 of them. So we'll write minus
negative 7.
Taking away negative 7 of them.
And similarly, we'll have minus. How much is left here when we do that? Right. So it'll be just the number 1, because there'll be 0 b's. Right? Because if here's negative if here is negative 7 of them, and we take away negative 7 of them, how many? What will be the new exponent? 0. So to be clear, b to negative 7, and then minus negative 7. Like so.
Okay. Now, any question about getting here? Because this, all these negatives floating around and the fact that there's negatives at all, this is what disturbs students. So let's get comfortable right here before we forge on.
So how about this?
Okay.
Okay. 20a squared b to negative 7. And now let's carry out the arithmetic and the exponent. So 2a cubed. And then what is going to be the exponent here?
10.
10, right? Because 3 minus negative 7, which is to say 3 plus 7. That'd be 10. And then minus b. Negative 7 minus negative 7 is 0.
Of course, one of the b exponents had to be 0. Of course, one of them had to be 0, because that's the whole point of factoring out the greatest common factor, is at least one of them's going to be 0 when you've done that.
So this is 20 a squared b to negative 7, 2 a cubed b to 10, and then what is b to 0? 1, like so.
And now suppose that I said in the instructions to the exercise, I said, and express all of your, express your answer with only positive exponents. So does this satisfy that constraint? No. In what way does it not satisfy the constraint?
-7 adds adjacency.
Right. So that factor right there, b to negative 7, doesn't satisfy the constraint. So how do we make it satisfy the constraint?
Put it in the denominator.
Move it to the denominator.
So the answer is 20a squared 2a cubed b to 10 minus 1, and then all of this divided by b to 7.
Any question about this example? So in the end, the fundamental idea and the thing that you may have overlooked when we passed over this the first time is that when you're factoring things out, what you're doing is you're subtracting exponents from the thing inside of the parentheses. That's what you're doing.
when you factor out x squared, that means that you're subtracting 2 from the exponents of the x's. When you factor out b to negative 7, that means that you're subtracting negative 7 from the exponents. Okay, so now let's do another one, but let's do it quick, since we did this one in painstaking detail.
How about y to negative 3 plus 48 x to 3 y to negative 2.
Okay, I want you to factor this. So same instructions as last time. I want you to factor it completely and express your answer using only positive exponents.
Okay, so some of it is easy. Some of it is easy. The coefficients are straightforward. The x's are straightforward, I think. So then how much coefficient can we get out? 6. And what x-ness can we get out? X cubed, right? That's what we can get out. When we do that, taking 6 out of 30, what you have is 5. And then how much x is left in this one? A single x, right? Because here's 4 of them. And we're taking away 3. So that means just 1 is left. So x to 1. And I'm just going to leave the y's alone. And then plus, okay, taking the 6 out, what remains of the 48? 8. Because we're dealing with product now. Okay. Here were 3 x's. We took away 3, so there's none of those left. And then we're just doing nothing with the y's on this step.
Any question getting to that step? Okay. Now we need to deal with the y's. So how much y are we going to take out?
Negative 3,
because these are our choices, negative 3 or negative 2. These are the choices. And the choice is you always choose the smallest.
And of these two choices, negative 3 and negative 2, which is smaller? Negative 3. Now, statistically speaking,
just as having taught this course a number of times, there's a good probability that someone out there is saying, wait a minute, I thought negative 2 was smaller than negative 3. So why is that not right? It's not the leftmost one on the number line, right? So 2 is smaller than 3. That's a fact. Yes, 2 is smaller than 3. But negative 2 is bigger than negative 3 in the sense that, for example, to deal with money, it's preferable for you, I think, for you to owe 2,000 than to owe 3,000. Okay? So we're going to take out negative 3.
So when we do that, it'd be 6 x to 3 y to negative 3 5x. So,
from this first term that I'm dealing with, we're taking away negative 3, so how much y will be left when we do that? None. So it'll be y to 0, so I'll just leave it.
And then plus 8.
So here's negative 2, and we're taking away negative 3. So how much will remain when we do that? 1.
Right. So I'll write this one down, because I got some looks that were like, I'm not sure about that. Oh, wait. I need a y there. So y, we started with negative 2, and we're going to take away negative 3 of them.
Negative 2 minus negative 3, that is negative 2 plus 3, which is 1.
So 6x cubed y to negative 3, and then 5x plus 8y.
And then, if the request was express your answer using only positive exponents, then what? Right.
So 6x cubed, 5x plus 8y over y cubed.
Any question about this one? Okay. So,
to start with today, we said, here's that first problem we did last time. Let's make it more entertaining by making some of the exponents negative. Okay, so now let's start again with the same problem as last time, but let's make it more entertaining in a different way.
So how about like this? X cubed, and then now I'm going to write like this. How about x plus 5 to 9, and then plus x to 8, and x plus 5 to 4.
Okay. And what I want you to do is I want you to factor things out as much as possible. Okay. So let's deal with the... In fact, I'm going to put some numbers here because it'll make it just slightly easier on your brain, I think.
So I'll put a 6 in front of this one and an 8 in front of this one.
Okay. So as for the coefficients, what could you get out? 2.
So we could get out a 2. And then, ignoring this other stuff for a minute that looks new, and just looking at the x's, how much x could you get out?
3.
Right? So we could get out 6x to 3. Or sorry, 2x to 3. And if we do that, then this would be 3, and then x plus 5 to 9. Plus 4 x to 5 x plus 5 to 4.
Okay, so any question about getting here? So now, what I want you to observe
is that all the things that we've been doing to now, all that really matters is that we've got something to an exponent and that same thing to some possibly different exponent. That's all that matters. We're just calling that x, we're calling that x, that has exponent 3, that has exponent 8. Fine, we play this game where we mess around with the exponents. The exact same thing happens here to this one, which is to say, if I just call this one, instead of looking at it, instead of looking inside the box and saying that, oh, there's things in there, well, it's just a box. It just contains something.
Mm-hmm.
And that one just contains something. So we have red to 9, okay, and we have red to 4. So how much red can come out? 4, right? Because here's 9 of them, and here's 4 of them. 4 of them can come out.
So 2x cubed, and then x plus 5 to 4 is what could come out. And then when we do this, this will be 3. And then how much of these remain when you take out these 4? 5 of them. So we'd have x plus 5 to 5, and then plus 4x to 5. And how much would remain here when we take these 4? None, right? So then those would just end.
Okay, and to help you, your eyes match the pattern.
So then we took out red box to 4, and what was left here was red box to 5, and there were none left there. Okay. Good. Any questions about this? Okay.
So now another complication.
How about this? 12, x to 7, y to 5/3, plus 18, x to 5, y to 2/3.
So now what's the complication that we're dealing with? Fractional exponents. Okay. At least they're not negative, right? I guess.
Okay.
But it's really just exactly the same thing as before.
It really is. So as for the coefficients, what can come out? 6. As for the x's, which are normal, what can come out? Right, so 6x to 5 can come out. When we do this, we'll have 2, right, because 12 over 6 is 2, and then how much x will we have here? 2, so x to 2, and then I'm putting off dealing with the y's for the moment. Plus 3, we took all the x's, so they're gone. And then y to 2/3. Hey, any question getting to that step? Okay. So now how much y can come out?
2/3.
2/3, right?
Because in the end, it's the same choice we've made numerous times today.
The choice is between taking 5/3 or 2/3. The answer is always the smallest, the lesser, the least. So we're going to take that much. 6, x to 5, y to 2/3, and then 2x squared is unchanged. And now here's the arithmetic. So y, we started with 5/3.
And how much are we taking?
2/3, so minus 2/3, and then plus 3y. We started with 2/3, and we're taking 2/3. Looks like this.
So now this one's pretty easy. 2/3 minus 2/3 is 0, and y to 0 is 1 for the fourth time today. And then 5/3 minus 2/3 is what? Is 3/3.
So that this is altogether a fancy way to say y to 1. So 6x to 5, y to 2/3, 2x squared, y to 1 plus 3 y to 0. And then, yes, write it simply as 6 x to 5 y to 2 thirds 2 x squared y plus 3.
Any question about this one? So now let's gather all of the complications together into a single exercise, right? Because that's what we were all waiting for.
So let's do it. So how about 24 and then x squared and then 3x minus 1 to negative 1 fourth so this is 4 times 6, so how about 5 times 6, 30. X and then 3x minus 1 to 7 fourths.
Okay, so now it's all in here and all messed up, right? So we've got fractional exponents, some of which are negative, and they're on these compound expressions. But what I want you to observe is that the pattern matching stuff that we've been doing all today, all of those things apply in exactly the same way that they've applied all day. So let's deal with the easy parts first, which is to say the coefficients and the x's. So how much coefficient and x can we get out?
6x,
right?
So 6x, and when we do that, this would be 4x, 3x minus 1 to negative 1 fourth, minus 5, 3x minus 1, 7 fourths.
Okay, notably, at this position, you can't get any more coefficient out, you can't get any more x's out. I'm not talking about that x, I'm talking about the exponents of x. Right, x squared and x to 1, can't get any more of them out. Okay, so now we need to deal with this. So how much 3x minus 1 are we going to take out? Negative 1 fourth. Why negative 1 fourth?
It's the smallest.
It is the smallest.
So, 6x, 3x minus 1 to negative 1 fourth. That's what we're taking out. When we do so, what is right here?
4x
minus 5. Okay, now this one is slightly complicated, so again, I'll show what we're doing. It's 3x minus 1, and we started with 7 fourths, and now we're taking away negative 1 fourth.
So you take away negative 1 fourth, which is to say you're adding a fourth. So how much, what is the new exponent after you do this? 2, right? Because it's 8 fourths. 8 fourths, which is 2.
6x, 3x minus 1 to negative 1 fourth, 4x minus 5, 3x minus 1 squared, like so.
And then supposing I said, I want you to write this using only positive exponents, then what?
Very good. So 6x, 4x minus 5, 3x minus 1 squared over 3x minus 1 to 1/4.
Terrific. Any question about this? So that's... This is the kind of thing that I just think of like, well, this is just a algebra circus, right? We're just seeing how many circus tricks we can do all at the same time. Nevertheless, this is the kind of thing that the state of Texas wants you to learn in college algebra. So, there you have it.
Any question about this? I like it.
Okay, good. Good. So, now, new topic. Rational expressions. Rational expressions. So, we need to define what that means. So, a rational expression is a ratio of two polynomials.
So we've been talking about polynomials primarily for the last week or two, and now we're just barely branching out just a little bit. We're saying now we're going to talk about fractions of polynomials. So two of them at the same time.
Okay. So, for example, 3x plus 4 divided by x squared plus 7.
So here's an expression. Is it a rational expression? Yes. So my question of you, is it a rational expression, is equivalent to you, is equivalent to me asking, Is it a fraction, and is the numerator a polynomial, and is the denominator a polynomial? So how about it?
Is the numerator a polynomial?
Yes.
Yes. What is the degree of the numerator?
1.
What is the leading coefficient of the numerator?
3.
Is the denominator a polynomial?
Yes.
What is the degree of the denominator?
2.
What is the leading coefficient of the denominator? 1. So is there any question about that litany of questions I just did? Okay. So is this a rational expression?
Yes. Okay. How about this one? Is 4 divided by 7x minus 5?
Is that a rational expression?
Yes.
It is. So I think we can all, well, I think all of us probably agree that the denominator is a polynomial. I think we're all there for that. Okay. The thing that might disturb you is how about the numerator? Is the numerator a polynomial? And the answer is yes. Because remember what a polynomial is. A polynomial is the sum of terms and, possibly, a constant. So a single constant by itself is a polynomial. It's called a constant polynomial. So is this the ratio of two polynomials? Yes.
Okay. How about x squared plus 1?
Is this a rational expression?
No.
Yes?
X over 1.
Because you could say that it is x squared plus 1 divided by 1. Okay, now.
So what that means is that every polynomial, all the polynomials that exist, including all the polynomials that we've ever written in this class, all of them are rational expressions. Now, this is analogous to the following situation, is that, for example, 5 is an integer. Just a plain fact, 5 is an integer. And the set of rational numbers is the ratio of integers. So, for example, 3 over 4 is a rational number. Okay. Is 5 a rational number? Yes. Why is 5 a rational number? I thought 5 was an integer. Because it can be expressed as 5 over 1, or 50 over 10, or a lot of other ways, right? So every integer is a rational number. In exactly the same way, every polynomial is a rational expression. Okay? So that's a rational expression, that's a rational expression, that's a rational expression. Constants, the constant 5, that's a rational expression.
How about this one? Is that a rational expression? It is not. So why is this one not a rational expression? Why is this one not? It has to do with, well,
so that's radical, second radical, it's square root. What fractional exponent corresponds to square root? 1/2. And what must be true about the exponents for polynomial terms? They must be positive integers, right? So things like x to 3, that's fine. X to 33, that's fine. X to 33.1, not fine. So this is x to 1/2, not fine.
This is not a polynomial, and therefore it is not a rational expression. Okay, how about the square root of 3x plus 5?
Is that a polynomial and therefore a rational expression?
Yes.
It is. So is this a polynomial and therefore a rational expression? Yes. Now, some of you are saying, now wait a second, you just chastised me about radicals and now I'm gun-shy about about radicals. Well, what's the distinction here?
Well, one's a degree and one's a
coefficient, right. So the question is look at that x. What is its degree?
1.
Is that a legitimate degree for a polynomial? Sure is. That's just some number. That's its coefficient. There's no restriction on the coefficients of polynomials. So the reason why this is not acceptable is because it amounts to a fractional exponent for the x, whereas this is fine. Okay, so yes. Good.
Now we have a definition. So, and this definition that we're writing down is
probably one of the most important definitions in the class, both conceptually and for where the point of view of grades are concerned. We're going to ask so many exercises that either directly or indirectly deal with this definition.
This is the definition of natural domain. So, given an expression, in x. The natural domain of the expression is the set of all x's for which the expression is defined. So,
a stereotypically opaque math definition, right? So let's try and make the point clear by doing some examples.
So for example, I could say, well, how about 8 divided by x minus 3? And I want you to find the natural domain. So the question is,
for this expression, just what x's can you plug in there? And it's a legal thing to do. Okay. Well, could we plug in 19? Yeah. Right? Because the numerator would be 8, and then it'd be 19 minus 3, which is 16. 8 over 16, that's half. There's nothing wrong with half. Half's fine. Okay, could you plug in 19 million? Yeah. It'd be 8 over a number that's almost 19 million. And who knows what its decimal expansion is, but it's a perfectly legitimate number. Could we plug in negative 5? Would that be fine? Yeah. The numerator, again, would be 8. The denominator would be negative 5 minus 3, which is negative 8. 8 divided by negative 8, that's negative 1. That's fine. So, can we plug in just any number whatsoever? Any number at all? What would not be acceptable? Okay, so I heard 0 and I heard 3. Okay, so why is 3 not okay? Yeah, because the denominator would be 0. So if you tried to plug in 3, you'd have 8 divided by 3 minus 3. You'd have 8 divided by 0. This is not defined. Could you plug in 0? Yeah, that'd be fine, because then it'd be 8 divided by 0 minus 3. 0 minus 3 is negative 3, so it'd be 8 over negative 3. Nothing wrong with that number. That's legitimate. So the only thing that you can't do is you cannot cause a division by 0. And the only way that's going to occur in this particular expression is if you were to attempt to plug in 3.
So the answer to the question is of what is the natural domain of this is anything but 3. So all x except 3.
Any question about that one? Okay.
How about this one then? X minus 9 divided by x plus 5.
So now what? Okay, let's think about it for a minute. So, do we all agree about negative 5? Negative 5 is not going to work. For the same reason that positive 3 would not work on the previous one. But what about 9? Would 9 be okay? 9 would be fine. Why would 9 be fine?
Because
it's 0. Because it's 0, right? So, if you plug in 9, you'd get 0 in the numerator and 14 in the denominator. Is it okay 0 over 14?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's 0. 14 over 0? Not okay. Right? But 0 over 14 is just fine. That's 0. It would be just like if you went to a party and they ordered a pizza and they cut the pizza into 14 pieces, but you were 3 hours late, so that when you got to the party, you got 0 out of 14 of the pieces. All right? That'd be just fine. Well, numerically, right? Numerically, it'd be fine.
Okay, so then all x except x is negative 5. Okay? Almost done. So what if, continuing this, I say, how about 10 divided by x minus 2 multiplied by x plus 5? Well, how about this?
Plus its natural domain.
Because it's except 2.
Right, everything except, now there's two exceptions. So we can't use 2, right? There's nothing's ever going to go wrong in the numerator. It's 10. 10's just going to do its thing. But if you plug in 2, then this factor would be 0, and it doesn't even matter what this other one is, because we're going to multiply them, and the whole thing's 0. Similarly, for this one, that one can't be negative 5, because if this one's, if x is negative 5, then that factor is 0, and the whole thing is 0.
So the natural domain is all x except x is 2 and x is negative 5. So here's the last one, the one I want you to think about. What about x plus 4 divided by x squared plus 20x plus 36.
What about this one?
Factor it.
Ah, right, got to factor it. Right. In the end, what we need to know is we need to know when this thing down here is 0. It was easy to tell when this one is 0 because of the way it was represented. So can we represent this one in that way? Of course, by factoring.
So then it would be in the numerator, x plus 4. And then how does that factor in the denominator? Two numbers whose product is 36. Whose sum is 20?
Two and 18.
So now that we've represented the denominator in that way, I hope it's clear.
All numbers are fine except
negative 2 and negative 18.
Okay, have a nice weekend.